Hello, everybody, and welcome again to third day of this workshop. So this is the second talk of the day that we'll have now. And I'll wait a little bit until everybody has had the chance to join in. Okay, so as mentioned, this is the workshop on next generation quantum clocks arranged by the USOX, the QClocks, and CC4C consortia, all consortia within the EU, focusing on improving optical atomic clocks and frequency standards. And today is about ion clocks and ion trap systems. This next talk will be from Tanja Milstaubler. Tanja is from Leibniz University Hanover and PTB, working on ion traps and in particular on many ion systems, so generating Coulomb crystals and using these kind of systems to improve on ion atomic clocks. After the talk, there'll be the chance to post questions. You're welcome to write questions in the Q&A during the talk as well, but unless they're urgent, I might wait until the end of the talk to raise them up. And you'll also have the chance to ask the questions directly to Tanja. So with that, Tanja, I'll give the word to you. And thank you very much for coming here.
Yeah, thank you, Stefan. So then I will jump right away into media series. So thanks for inviting, and it's a pleasure to give the talk here. I will use the next 45 minutes to tell you a little bit about, well, ion crystal clock. That's the topic I was asked to lecture today. And actually, I slightly reworded it on the way to an ion crystal clock, because ion crystal clocks actually don't tick yet. So this is still a fundamental research project, and we're on a very good way to it, and actually hoping that we'll have the first serious clock measurements by maybe the end of the year. But as you will see in a few minutes, it's a long way to go to really prove that an ion crystal clock can be as accurate like a single ion clock. And this is what I would like to speak to you in the next 45 minutes. I'm from the consortium of the Cooler Crystals for Clocks, the symbol you see here, and actually this is one of these ytterbium Cooler crystals that we're using as kind of a logo for us. Well, Stefan already said it, in our research group we're dealing with many ions with Cooler crystals, and I just wanted to give you a short overview so that you know. It's basically split up in three research groups. One is dedicating its work to the many-body physics with trapped ions. So this is a very rich, very complex physics. We're dealing with defects, topological defects. We can even study nanofriction, frictional dynamics, transport effects. So everything that you know also from a solid-state system. It's basically a Cooler crystal is a very well-controlled solid-state system, but highly complex. The other research group is dealing then with the high precision spectroscopy and indium and ytterbium ion Cooler crystals. This is basically the core of the talk I'm giving today. I will deep further there. And the last part is also along a similar research route. This is the development of compact and scalable linear ion traps for metrology. So all three ingredients are basically needed to develop and to realize ion crystal clock. So the outline of my talk is that I first want to start with a little introduction to those of you who are maybe not so familiar with the business of optical clocks based with trapped ions. Then guide you a little bit into our multi-ion approach, talk about the physics of cooler crystals, and also highlight some systematic shifts that come across when you want to build a clock based on a cooler system. Also here, due to the limited amount of time, naturally, I cannot go into all systematic shifts. There's a big list in it. So I will discuss the largest one and give you some selected examples. And as an outlook, I will show you a little bit the work that we're doing here in the scalable ion trapping platforms. Well, how about optical clocks? How does an optical clock work? I think most of you know it because we had already very nice talks in this Ampere meeting about all different approaches from Rydberg clocks, squeezed and entangled clocks. So just a short repetition, the heart of optical clock is basically our local oscillator. This is a laser in the optical to UV domain, which needs to be pre-stabilized on a ultra-stable cavity. This is how we usually do it in our lab. That's a photo of our cavity. So this provides us the short-term reference to have a narrow enough laser to interrogate some highly forbidden lines in an atom. So we would like to drive some atomic quantum jumps to excite the atom from the ground to the excited state with the help of our laser. For this, we need a pre-stabilized laser. And then on the long term, so while this is just the short-term stabilization, on the long term, then I can stabilize my laser onto the atomic signal, right? So since this is an atomic reference, then it really makes sure that the frequency I'm measuring is only governed by natural constants and not by anything else. Every laser will drift away because of temperature and pressure fluctuations, but the atom, the atomic reference stays constant and makes sure that my atomic clock is a very good reference and also a possible definition for the SI unit for the second. The laser then you have to measure, of course, but here I will not go into the details. Usually you find here a femtosecond laser, a frequency comb, and there you can divide down the very fast oscillation frequency of a laser with 10 to the 15 oscillations per second, and you divide it down and you can count even the ticks per second, basically. You can really count the second. So since this is an experimental talk, I thought I also show you quickly an overview of how our local oscillators work. So these ultra-stable cavities that we have in our labs, they already provide us with a rather good frequency stability, so kind of a short-term clock by itself. And the frequency stabilities that we're achieving here is on the order of 10 to the minus 16 in 1 second. And at PTB, we even have the world best laser per se in the neighboring lab. This is then a cavity cryogenically cooled to really ultra low temperatures of 124 Kelvin. And that has right now a frequency stability of even below 10 to minus 16 in the 17-ish range. So this is basically the heart of our optical clocks here. But now, as I said, since these guys will drift away with time, we now have to talk about the atomic reference. What can we use here? You have seen it in previous talks. You have basically two types of atomic references. One are the neutral atoms and one are the ions. Neutral atoms, you can trap many of them. So they have thousands or even 10,000 atoms that they can store in an optical lattice and do clock spectroscopy. So the world record in the highest stability is at the moment held by the neutral lattice clocks. Here are some recent publications. On the other side, the single trapped ions, this is really just one single atom levitated in an ultra high vacuum chamber, perfectly shielded from the environment. They at the moment still hold the record for the highest accuracy, and they touch already the, upper 10 to minus 19 region for the uncertainty. So ions can be really well controlled and separated from the environment and give you the lowest sensitivity to external fields. But there's a big difference. You only have a single atom or a single ion that you interrogate. So now in the talk, I focus, of course, on the ions. Just in a nutshell, to summarize, how do we trap ions? Because this will also make you aware of the problems that can come up and the systematic shifts they can pose. So the non-trapping theorem basically Maxwell tells you that if you have a whatever electronic configuration that you want to use to trap your charged particle, every electric field line coming in also will have to come out. So that equation tells you, Maxwell's equation, the divergence of the electric field is zero. And in terms of potential, it means that you have like a saddle well potential. You're confining in one direction and repulsive in the other direction. So what do we have to do in order to trap the charged particle inside? We have to shake the potential. Instead of applying DC electric fields, we have to apply RF fields, radio frequency fields, that are constantly changing their amplitude and direction in time. Animate it again. So you see, if you shake your potential fast enough so that the inert mass cannot leave in time, you actually create such a time average potential. We call it a ponderomotive potential, which is always confining. And this is how RF ion trap works. Well, if you want to understand the equations of motions, they are rather complex. These are the Mathieu equations. Don't worry, you don't have to memorize them. But what they tell you is basically that you can separate the ion motion into different types. One is the secular motion and one is the micromotion. Secular motion is called the thermal motion, basically, just the oscillation amplitude of this harmonic oscillator. The micromotion is the driven motion coming because of this very fast RF field that you apply. As you might have noticed in the beginning there, if the charged particle is in the center of this trapping potential, it will not really feel that the potential is shaking. But if the particle leaves the center of the trap and goes to the outskirts, then it will see suddenly this RF field. And this is actually a quite significant field, which puts in a huge amount of kinetic energy. And you see here a beautiful picture already from the late 1950s, Wirke and Langmuir. At that time, they trapped aluminum metal in such an RF trap. And you see here this micromotion. In the center, the particle doesn't oscillate, but outside you see a very, very big oscillation, the micromotion. So you get a very nice Lisa Shu figure. That's basically, you see the overlap of the secular motion and then the micromotion. Also here you see a crystal out of aluminum metal flakes, small little metal flakes. And they could take at that time already a beautiful picture of this micromotion. And that's a very important thing to memorize. If you trap charged particles in these RF ion traps that are used nowadays for optical clocks, you always have to deal with micromotion. And and you see that the amplitudes can get really significant. And too much kinetic energy is, of course, really bad for a clock because it will give you all different kinds of systematic shifts. So how about the accuracy of single ion clocks that we're operating at PTB, for instance? Here's a photo of one of our single ion traps where we trap a single ytterbium ion. And why are they so good? So the accuracy definitely profits from the very deep trap depth, where you can say the trap depth, if you express it in terms of temperatures, 10 to the 4 Kelvin. So it's really tremendously deep. And even a collision with a background particle will not kick out your ion and destroy the clock. So we can actually trap the ions for, let's say several weeks up to a month. You can keep a single ion trap for several months in your ion trap. The confinement is very strong. It's a very stiff confinement. So the wave function of this trapped particle in the ground state, for instance, has a width of only a few nanometers, say on the order of 10 nanometers. So that means you know very precisely with nanometer precision where is your trapped particle? What are the electric field it sees? What is the magnetic field? You can perfectly characterize the environment sensed by your trapped ion. And that's the big strength of the ion clock. Last but not least, you have a really high level of control of the internal and external degrees of freedom. Yeah, the internal degrees of freedom is, of course, the spin. Is it in a ground state? Is it an excited state? But you also have a good control over the external degrees of freedom, basically the oscillation, the motion of the trapped particle in your ion trap. And in quantum mechanics, as you know, everything is quantized. So also the motion of the trapped particle is quantized. This is indicated here, the harmonic oscillator and the quantized phonons. And with the help of lasers nowadays, you can even cool down and prepare the ion in absolute ground state, the quantum mechanical ground state of this harmonic oscillator. So for this, as maybe you know, 2012, Dave Wineland received the Nobel Prize for his groundbreaking experimental methods that allow us nowadays to manipulate and measure the single quantum system. And these are basically the same methods that people are using nowadays to build quantum computers based on trapped ions or quantum simulators. And if you look at the uncertainty budget of those single ion clocks, so these are now recent examples, like from 2019 and 16, the ytterbium single ion clock, the aluminum single ion clock at NIST in Boulder, and this is the clock at PTB. So they're doing really exceptionally well. They're getting down to the low 10 to minus 18, or here even to the 10 to minus 19 region. But what I highlighted here in yellow is good parts, the dominant uncertainties that you have in these ion clocks, they're still ion trap related, so very technical nature. So keep that in mind when we're now talking about many ion systems. I was talking now all the time about accuracy. So how precise can I measure, determine my frequency? Now I would like to speak about the statistics. So how long do I have to measure until I can really resolve my frequency? Because if I have a lot of noise, I might have to average for a very long time. So we're also interested in the stability, or what we call the instability of our clock. And if you look at ion clocks, this is the current stability of a typical optical ion clock with a single particle. This is the Allen deviation. This is basically a modified way of expressing the statistical uncertainty, the sigma of the noise. You start here, it's a double logarithmic plot. You start at 1 second at around 10 to minus 15. So this is the resolution you get in 1 second. In order to go down to 10 to minus 18, you have to average, you have to wait. You have to take data and keep on taking data. Your laser should be in lock, everything should operate well. And only after several tens of days, you hit the 10 to minus 18 limit. And if you want to go beyond 10 to minus 18, you even have to measure for many, many weeks, up to 100 days. So that puts a natural limit and really a fundamental problem to nowadays single ion clocks. So the question is, how can we improve this? And if you look at the equation for our Allen deviation of this frequency noise, you see different ingredients. So tau is the averaging time. How long do I wait? How long do I take data? And it goes with the square root of 1/tau. This is the slope that you see here. On the other side, we have here the number of particles. This is under the same square root. So if you have a neutral atomic lattice clock with 10,000 particles, you already profit by a factor 100 in the stability. But actually, in the averaging time, you profit by a factor 10,000. Yeah? Or let me speak in different words in the terms of ions. If instead of one, a single ion, if I have two ions, I have to average only half the time. It goes really linearly with the averaging time. Here we also have the Q factor. This is another ingredient that we have, and people are working on this. We're also working on that, but it's rather tough and challenging because it's limited by the line width of the laser, of your ultra-stable laser that I showed you before, the clock laser. So how far can you push this? And it's also limited by the line width of the atom. How long you interrogate it? So what's then your Fourier broadening? How well can I resolve the line width? and many things pushing the quality factor bring in additional problems. So I think we have to work on both sides. Yeah, we cannot focus only on one single control parameter, but apart from pushing the quality factor to longer and longer interrogation times and dark times, we also have to push the number of ions for optical ion clocks. And this is what brings me to the multi-ion approach. Well, in 2012, we proposed the idea, why don't we take a single ion and just scale it up to a Kuhlau crystal? Here you can see the simplest of the Kuhlau crystals, like a linear chain of ions. For instance, 37 ion, this is all that fitted here on our CCD camera chip. And if I have a Kuhlau system of 37 ions, I can get the same information in one day of averaging that I would get here with a single ion clock in 37 days of averaging. So you understand immediately the big profit from this approach. But the question is, can we keep a good control over such a Kuhlau crystal? So what we need now, we say, we need experimental methods that allow to manipulate and measure many body quantum systems, not single quantum systems anymore, but a many body quantum system that needs to be controlled with metrological precision. And that's, of course, the basis for everything. What we say, what we call is a multi-ion clock, a multi-ensemble clock, or quantum logic clocks. If you're thinking of squeezed clocks, entangled clocks, well, you need to have more than one qubit. You need to scale it up to many particles, but keep the systematic control of the many-body system. So we're using basically very similar techniques. Our community is called quantum metrology, but we're using the same tools now than quantum simulation and quantum information people use who are dealing with trapped ion quantum computers. I would also like to highlight and mention here at this place another proposal that followed 3 years later in the group of Mary Barrett in University of Singapore, where they published a nice paper about the prospects for an atomic clock based on large ion crystals. In this paper, they were speaking about 5,000 ions in a Kuhlau crystal. And later on, they followed these ideas with many nice papers where they're dealing about how could they potentially suppress systematic shifts in such large ion Kuhlau crystals. And I refer you to their publications. I will not have time in this talk to go through all their papers, and they have many, many nice ideas. But in the given time frame that I've set here, I would like to focus now on the systematics and the fundamental problems that we see with the ion Kuhlau crystal, how we can really go to 10 to minus 18 and 19. And I would like to tell you a little bit further our approach, which is kind of a bottom-up approach, I would say. Because so far nobody has shown and demonstrated a clock operating with 2 or 3 ions. So our answers, our approaches, can we scale up a single ion to a 10-ion system, 50, maybe 100-ion system? And the way we think to do this is by scalable ion traps. So we want to trap small but very well-controlled Kuhlau crystals up to 10 or 20 ions in a single ion trap, and then have an array of ion traps that are scalable so that we can multiply it and have hundreds of ions. But the idea is to keep control over small systems and not to go to too large systems, because the phonon dynamics we're at the moment very scared of. And I will show you in a few minutes why. Such an ansatz, such an approach is of course also a perfect basis for cascaded clock interrogation. For instance, what had been published then in 2013 in this PRL by Sørensen and Beauregard, where they're proposing a cascaded clock where you can stabilize your clock laser, your local oscillator, onto such an ensemble of ions or atoms, and then later on in a different dark time, dark period, on another ensemble of atom, and you build basically a multi-ensemble clock where you can always stabilize further and further your laser and actually even do a phase measurement. Not only frequency measurement, but you can track and follow the phase evolution of your laser. And by this, you will get an even faster scaling. You can average down with 1/tau, not square root of tau, but 1/tau. So that's also a very, very nice approach, but you need a platform for that. Well, I was talking always about platforms. So how can we trap now really many ions? How can we trap tens, hundreds of ions in a Powell trap, given the multi, the micro motion that I've shown you before? You have this very strong radio frequency fields, which you would like to avoid. So what people are doing who are building quantum computers, they also have to deal with many qubits. They're going to linear ion traps. So here you have a nodal line, this is the red line. And along this line, you have zero electric RF fields. The challenges that come about, if you say, oh, well, let me just put atoms now in such a trap and scale it up. There are plenty of them. I just want to highlight a few, like on-axis micromotion, heating of the ions, excessive heating rate because of maybe you have contamination, patch potentials on the electrodes, the warming of the trap. You drive your trap with something like a kilovolt and you have a current of on the order of a few amps flowing through your trap electrodes. Ion traps have been seen to heat up by 150 degrees Celsius, so that will give you huge black body shifts. Magnetic fields and gradients. Now, if you're talking about a spatially extended cooler system, we also have to deal now with homogeneities and how well we can control all the gradients. The first things are all trap related. Again, very technical. And I'd say for a multi-ion system, even more challenging than for a single ion system. But I cannot go into all the technical details here. I don't want to do this because I could speak now for 2 hours about how to build an ideal ion trap. If you have questions, feel free to ask me. We also have papers on that and many other groups have papers on that, excellent papers, but it's really a full talk by itself. So let me just mention at the end, the control of the many body system. This is now independent of the ion trap. And this is about the phonodynamics that I will mention in this talk and get in more detail. So I think the only thing I would like to point out is, let me see, the on-axis micromotion. This is something So the on-axis micromotion is something that maybe not everybody is aware of, that it's not so trivial to just throw in ions in an ion trap and be sure that you have no micromotion and everything is well controlled. This is actually not the case. So if you look at a very simple ion trap, you can think of an ion trap as a capacitor. You have two electrodes and it's like a capacitor. But if you know if the capacitor has a finite size, you do get finite size effects. The electric fields will bend around. They're not really orthogonal between the plates. And the same thing happens in an ion trap. So if you just look close enough, you always will find a deviation from an ideal ion trapping field. And this is what we do by using finite element simulations and calculations of ion traps. And then we see actually the wiggles and the deviation along, this is the axial line where the ions are basically stored. And instead of being always zero, you do get significantly large RF fields for the ions. And this is what we call on-axis micromotion, on-axis radio frequency fields. So our ion traps look a bit more complex than a simple linear ion trap. This is what we have developed at PTB. They are integrated and scalable. So in each of these little segments, you can trap ions. So this is basically now a linear array of one ion trap after the other. We do have temperature sensors on board, PT100 sensors, where we can read out the temperature with a few tens of millikelvin precision. So we always know the environment that our ions are seeing. And if you're interested in this, I refer you to some publications where it was shown that the ion trap really does not heat up. Actually, this should be a delta T, I apologize for this. So the temperature rise is less than a Kelvin. But I have to emphasize the absolute temperature of the ion trap. It's at room temperature, it's not a cryogenic system. So this is now an example how we put such an ion trap in the vacuum chamber. You see here two PhD students who are doing the job. So you get an idea about the sizes of the vacuum chamber and the ion trap. We have an imaging system with which we can then detect the fluorescence of single ions. So this is the ion trap. Here's the imaging system. This is rather close to the ions so that we can have really single atomic resolution. And afterwards, when you put in a new ion trap in a vacuum chamber, you have to do a bakeout. Now you have to heat everything because at the end, we want to get a very good vacuum pressure in the 10 to minus 11 millibar regime. So how does it work when we load ions in such an ion trap? I would like to show you some real-time video. And actually what you see here, you see nothing because there's not a single ion in the trap yet. And you see now here the arrival of ion by ion. So atomic ions, ytterbium ions, that are right now being loaded into the ion trap. This is basically a video imaged onto our CCD camera. And the ions are fluoresced by some laser light. And the fluorescence is collected. What you see now, we switch off the repumper, which is basically emptying the clock states and shelving it back to the ground state. And now you can detect the different qubit states. If they're in the ground state, they're bright. If they're in the clock state, they're dark. That's why you can also distinguish the different atoms, how they're dancing around. And you see what a big fast dynamics is in such a Kuhlow system during the loading process. I repeat it again, you see really atom by atom arriving in the trap. And at a certain time, due to collisions, the ions are shelved into the meter-stable clock state and they remain dark. And as long as they're in this quantum state, you don't see them. If they're quenched by another collision, they come back to the ground state. And this makes the atoms distinguishable. That's how you see how they move around in the trap. Okay, then let me just show you this video. I think that's also quite nice. This is now with all the lasers on. So the ions are now constantly fluorescing. They're always in the ground state and being detected by our CCD camera. And here you see already like a three-dimensional Kuhlow crystal. You see already the depth of the field, how the ions are sometimes focused, sometimes out of focus. And we're changing the trap parameters now. So that's why the crystal configuration is changing. We're doing now some laser cooling. So we're moving them from a 3D, 2D, now slowly to a linear 1D crystal. Okay. So that brings me to the chapter Kuhlow crystals. What is it about? I mean, why are they really crystals? In the beginning, sometimes it looks like this when you load it. If you load many ions in an ion trap, you see just some hot plasma, some hot liquid, which is very blurry. It's a very interesting system. It's super nonlinear, very chaotic dynamics, self-organized. That's why you can do a lot of beautiful many-body physics with it. But at the beginning, as I said, it's rather uncorrelated. Yeah, as long as the kinetic energy is larger than the potential energy, it doesn't crystallize. And actually, there's a nice parameter to distinguish in which regime you are. There's a nice review of modern physics from 1999, where Dubin is discussing the coupling parameter gamma. So that's basically this ratio of the potential interaction energy with the kinetic energy per degree of freedom. And if this coupling parameter gamma is smaller than one, then we say we're in a weakly correlated regime. You have basically a liquid or a plasma. If you're an ion trapper, typical distances that you know from your ion traps, the distance between the ions is on the order of a few micrometer or tenth of micrometer. So that tells you you have this weakly correlated regime if your ions have a temperature larger than 3 Kelvin, which is actually not so much. So 3 Kelvin is already pretty cryogenic, pretty cold. If you want to go to the strongly correlated regime, you have to increase the gamma to be larger than 1. And the liquid phase is between 1 and 174. This is actually what this liquid phase is looking like in our ion trap. And now if we lower the temperature even further by laser cooling, then we get crystallization. And that typically happens at a temperature below 20 millikelvin. So very close to the absolute zero point of energy, of temperature in the universe. And this, of course, we do by laser cooling of the ions. And then we get beautiful cooler crystals, BCC, FCC structure. You get very nice crystal formation. You get 3Ds, you get 2D zigzags, and 1D crystals. And how you can choose what kind of crystal you have? Well, this is you as an experimentalist. You can decide what is basically the aspect ratio of your trapping potential, of your ion trap. Depending on the voltages that you set, if you make a very oblate or prolate ion trap, if you squeeze it or relax it, by changing the aspect ratio of the trapping potential, you can choose then one of the three phases your ion cooler crystal is in. And as I said, it's a really a little solid state system. So you can also look at the phonons of this cooler crystal. And you will see you get acoustic modes, optical modes, everything you know from solid state. And when it gets really crazy is when you get close to a phase transition, then basically the Brillouin zone flips back and gets half the size. And you see here some modes are really touching the zero. You get some soft modes that are getting very, very weak. And this is of course also very critical for a clock, because then you have a very weak mode, which is not in a strong confinement anymore for the expert. They're not in the Lemnicki regime anymore. And then everything becomes very messy. So the more ions you have, the more critical, because you can have phase transitions, defects, and it's very hard to control actually the phonons of such a many-body system. Well, let me now talk about the systematic shifts of the cooler crystal clocks. What do we have to care about? One thing is the largest one for many ions is the quadrupole shift. Why? Well, I told you that the electric field vanishes. At the place of the ions, the electric field is always zero by nature. Otherwise, they would have to move, then there would be an electrical force. So the field is zero, but the gradient is finite. The gradient of the electric field is unequal to zero. You have a curvature of the potential. And that means if you have any quadrupole moment in your electron shells, if you don't have a very symmetric electron shell, you can interact with electric field gradients. And that gives you so-called quadrupole shifts. They can be large, they can be small. I show you here for some prominent examples that we have in our Ampere consortium, like the aluminum ions, the indium ions, and the terbium ions. And these are very, very good clock ions because they have a very small quadrupole moment in the clock state. And that gives you very small quadrupole fields on the level of 10 to minus 20, 21, or here 10 to minus 17. So this is actually something that we believe even in a multi-ion approach will be able to control that in a very good way. We're dealing, as I said, with indium and ytterbium ions. Indium is sympathetically cooled by ytterbium in our setup. Here I just show for the expert what we expect with our indium ytterbium clock. I refer to these publications if you're interested in the details. But basically, this quadrupole shifts, they're tensorial shifts. So in principle, they can be even minimized and canceled. They could be put to zero, if you like. Here we show the maximum value. We don't show the minimum, but we show the maximum value to be very conservative. And for the indium ion clock, depending on our trapping parameters, this is basically the secular frequency, and this is a typical parameter that we can achieve in our ion trap, we can bring this shift even in the low 10 to minus 20 region. So that's why we, at the moment, as long as we don't cross the 10 to minus 19 border, we don't really care about it. For other clocks, like the ytterbium clock, it's more relevant. There, these type of shifts already in the 10 to minus 17, and for strong confinement, even in the 10 to minus 16 region. Then let me mention micromotion, because I told you, how sure can we really be that this very fast radio frequency driven motion really vanishes? If you have a finite cooler system, even on the nodal line, how well can you be sure that there is no micromotion? Well, we had to measure that, and actually for the first time, somebody measured this in a cooler crystal system. Just in a nutshell, this is basically a very fast intensified CCD camera where you can gate it with nanosecond precision, the arrival of the photons. So we can measure with nanoseconds the binning, which photon arrives when with respect to the radio frequency. And we can do a lock-in measurement. We can measure the fluorescence of the ions at the frequency of the RF drive. In our case, it's 25 megahertz. And with this technique, we could make very beautiful pictures. This is an actual measurement, a 3D animation of micromotion across a cooler crystal. And I hope it reminds you of the photos I've shown you before of Wirken Langmuir from the 1950s. They have used really big aluminum metal particles, really flakes of aluminum, and made a photo of such micromotion. We have done the same now, but with single atoms. This is really atom by atom, pearled up in such a cooler crystal. And we measured the micromotion with amplitudes of nanometer. So the precision how we could resolve this tiny micromotion was at the nanometer level. And that's very important for the clock. With this, we could show that even in such a cooler crystal of tens of ions, you can control this micromotion at the level of 10 to minus 19 for very significant large spatial extent. So that's very promising. Speaking about motion, and motion always gives you time dilation, that's a relativistic effect. We not only care about micromotion, but also about thermal motion. As you know, in a coupled system, I showed you the phonons, things are oscillating. This is actually a photo of how the phonons look in our Coulomb crystals. You have here center of mass mode, you have here breathing mode, here you have two nodes, basically the Egyptian mode. Well, you can excite different modes and types of oscillation in your Coulomb crystal. And you have to understand each single one of them. So if you have a composite system, things become even worse. If you, for instance, sympathetically cool indium with ytterbium, like the yellow guys or the ytterbium ions, the blue ones are in indium, depending on your ion configuration, you can have modes that cannot be cooled sympathetically. They decouple. Like here, for instance, you see something, the ytterbium ions are not moving at all anymore. You think they're already cold, but the indium ions have very large amplitudes. This is what I'm showing here. This is the eigenvector of the system, the eigenvector of this phonon. And while you can't do anything or not much anymore on the ytterbium, the indium ions are still very rather hot and have a big oscillation amplitude. And this is very bad for a clock because that gives you time dilation shifts. So we have investigated that, and for different cooling parameters, we could show that the time dilation shifts, even in cooler crystals, we think we handle them. This is now an estimated error budget at the level of a few 10 to minus 18. And this is really the time dilation shift atom by atom for this example configuration. Outside are the indiums. Inside would be the ytterbium ions that are used for sympathetic cooling. And for the experts in the audience, I just would like to mention in the last slide that not only caring about accuracy, but also caring about stability comes in when we're talking about this phonons and the thermal motion. Because if you have a lot of phonons and a lot of thermal motion in the system, it not only reduces your accuracy, it can also actually deteriorate your stability because of the Debye-Waller effect. If you have many, many phonons coupled to each other and each of the phonons has some thermal excitation, well, you actually reduce the excitation probability on your carrier transition. When you try to excite the qubit with a laser, instead of having 100% excitation efficiency, it reduces it dramatically. It can go, you could even potentially reduce it to zero. So here, of course, we have found a good compromise so that it works for our clock. But if you're not careful, you don't get a good qubit Rabi frequency anymore. And even worse, not only the Rabi frequency goes down, but also the noise of the excitation probability goes up. So in worst case, if you have a lot of phonons that you have to drive and even some thermal occupation in the phonons, you easily deteriorate your initial stability. And instead of improving your stability of the clock and pushing it further to the 10 to minus 16, 17 region, you actually bring it up. So that's why you have to be very careful about these phonons. All the details, I think, have been exquisitely explained already by Dave Wineland himself in the end of the 90s in this journal here. So I refer to these publications if you want to know the details here. Okay, so let me summarize what we believe we have shown in a small Kuhlaus system. And with small, I mean something like 10, 15 ions. When we characterize all the systematics in this Kuhlaus system, we do have a very good control right now at the level of 10 to minus 19. So all the leading systematic shifts coming from this Kuhlaus system are nowadays controlled at the level of 10 to minus 19. And I think this is very encouraging. So with this, we really can start scaling it now. And at the very end, I would like to show you something what so far it looked like in our lab. So you see fluorescing ytterbium ions, and the dark ones are the indium ions, the qubits where you do the clock spectroscopy. Very recently, we have also seen the indium fluorescing. I think it's very pretty because now you see a composite Kuhlauer crystal with dual species. We have indium ions and we have ytterbium ions in the same crystal. They fluoresce at different wavelengths. And why they're looking so funny is we have basically an imaging system where we can focus and adjust the fluorescence of the different ions with independent mirrors. And then we don't overlap them so that we don't drown in stray light, but we slightly align them on top of each other. So you can see here the fluorescence of the indiums and the fluorescence of the terbiums, but they're all in the same crystal. So this basically fits in here. Yeah, and with this, I come to the end. Scalable trapping platforms. I just would like to show you, this is how an optical clock looks nowadays on the left side, very messy. And what we want to achieve is basically a more compact clock. This was done under the consortium of Optic Clock, a BMBF project. And as a part of this, we also produced a scalable ion trap so that even compact portable clocks nowadays will be able to operate then with multi-ion clocks, with crystal clocks. And pushing this further, we have other BMBF projects going on where we're going now towards micro-integration and optics. And this is basically the dream of the future, that you have then many, many small ion traps on such a chip scale, only connectorized with some fibers, and then you really can scale them up. 10 by 10 by 10 already gives you 1,000 ions, and this will be basically a compact portable ion clock that you can even use in the fields if you like. And with this, yeah, thanks for your attention, and yeah, I'm looking forward to questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tanya, for that very, very nice talk. It's very exciting if you can really reach that kind of accuracy in the near future on such systems. So then I want to encourage everybody to ask questions either in the Q&A or by raising your hand to me. And to start, we already have one question that was posed anonymous, so I don't think I can have that as a live question, but I'll just ask the question to you, Tanya. The person asks, the stability of the 30 centimeter cavity was shown to be at 1.1 10 to the minus 16 at 1 second. What is the space and material, and is it at room temperature?
Okay, yeah, so the space and material is ULE, like most of our Fabry-Perot cavities, Corning ULE, and it's actually a room temperature cavity. So the thermal limit for a 30 centimeter long ULE would be around 9 × 10⁻¹⁷ or so. So what we have achieved in the lab is already very close to the thermal noise limit. And what I should say, it's not only the spacer material that is limiting you there, it's also the material of the mirror substrates. And for this, we use fused silica because the quality factor is better and that reduces the thermal noise limit again. So if I would have everything made out of ULE, I would not be able to get those 1 times 10 to minus 16.
Okay, thank you. Then there's one other question from Georgi Kasakov about references for the articles that you shown. But I think I can answer that straight up by saying that the entire presentation here is recorded and will be put on YouTube. So for all participants, there's a possibility of rewatching it and pausing at the right moments to record the references that you're interested in.
Yeah, thank you. This was actually what I was counting on. So I rushed through some slides and I thought, okay, if somebody wants to write down the precise reference, feel free to rewatch.
Then I think I have one question that I'd like to ask you, which is, I guess, also just a technical question about making these crystals rather than the excellent control you have over them. So you showed this transition from a 3D crystal to a 1D crystal. And that's, is that happening in this extended trap you have, or is that within one trap section, if you can say that, that you have?
So the videos I've shown, they were taken in this nice golden trap, the scalable one, yeah, which looks rather complex with integrated electronics, SMD parts and everything. But of course the trap is rather macroscopic. This is one trap after the other. And if we focus down to get really single ion resolution, then we focus into one segment, into one trap. And there I've shown you the photos. So the phase transition, linear, zigzag, and so was happening within one segmented part of the trap. But what we also could do, I didn't show it here, we could also basically push in a dimple, split the cooler crystal. We can transport it from segment to segment and recombine. We can flop them around. You have a lot of control over these cooler crystals because you have so many electrodes. You can put, like in this trap, we can put 44 different DC voltages to squeeze, rotate, and manipulate the ion crystals.
Very nice.
May I have another question for you, Tanya? It is clear what you do to have a linear Paul trap, so that you have a linear crystal of, which is the topology of a trap that, if you can answer, to have a 3D crystal, it should be quite different, I suspect.
I know actually this, the 3D crystals that I've shown you,
yeah.
With helix and so, they're in the same trap. So I can get all three different phases by just changing the aspect ratio of my confinement. I have three dimensions, right? So X, Y, and Z. And I can basically give different confinement in the three directions to squeeze it, make it stiffer. And so the only thing that determines the phase is basically the aspect ratio of radial to axial confinement. And even if I have a perfectly isotropic radial ion trap, let's say I first have a linear string of ions, now I relax it, it will first get into the zigzag phase. I mean, the zigzag can, of course, then freely spin around. It's like a Goldstone mode if you have a perfect isotropy. Mm-hmm. But it's always the ground state is always a two-dimensional zigzag. And only if you relax further, you will undergo a second phase transition, which is then of first order. So the first one is a second order phase transition, then comes a first order phase transition, and then you go into the helix. Then you become three-dimensional. But it's really the same trap, basically.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I don't see any raised hands. So I think I'll... thank you again, Tanya, for a very nice talk, and thank the previous speaker from today, Guido Wilpers, as well, and then also my co-hosts here. And for all the attendees, I hope to see you again tomorrow for the final day of the workshop, which will also be somewhat in the realm of ions and ion flux again. Okay. Then thank you very much for listening in.
Okay.
See you tomorrow.
Thank you, Stefan.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. See you tomorrow.
Bye.
Okay, bye. I will see you all tomorrow, and I'm going to end the meeting now.
Okay.